Hello and welcome to NewsClick. There's a continuous environmental degradation that's going on, and also the spaces that are meant for public are diminishing day by day. Today we are going to discuss about these issues, and we are joined by Dr. Shiraz Wajih, who is president of Gorakhpur Environmental Action Group, which has been working on these issues since long. Welcome to NewsClick, sir.
Thank you.
So first of all, let's start with what was the idea behind forming this entire group? What came into your mind that you started this group and you thought that there's an intervention required in this field?
No, actually, I will take you back to the history of the organization. Actually, it was started something like 1975. And soon after Indira Gandhi spoke in the Stockholm conference in 1972, the famous conference actually with which all the environmental discussions were started in the whole world. And she spoke on the issue of poverty is the biggest polluter kind of statement was given, which was quite discussed throughout different countries. And it was the time actually when the environmental issues were understood. And that was, that started to be discussed in open forum and open domain in public also. So a number of movements were also going on at that time. It was quite an old thing actually, but still, like in South, there was Silent Valley Movement. In Kerala, there was Kerala Shastra Hit Parishad, which was relating the culture of the people and the environmental thing. The Chipko movement, the famous Chipko movement was going on. So a number of movements actually, environmental movements which were going on across the country, because of which a number of small action groups were formed. So Bombay Environmental Action Group, Ballampur Action Group, and the famous Ballampur Environmental Action Group was also formed, the Gorakhpur Environmental Action Group, Kalpavriksh, all these youth groups actually which came into existence as the action groups for taking this discourse of environment to the public and making it as a public issue, the environment not a kind of saving only trees or doing something around greens or something, but it's largely on the whole issue of looking environment as something which is contributing to the poverty. There's also something actually which is linking with the livelihoods, and environment and development to be taken together. So that was the establishment of the organization. So we were some of the research students working in Gorakhpur University at that time who came together and formed this Gorakhpur Environmental Action Group.
So how does the group function? What are the focus areas that you aim at? Is there people's participation that you aim at? And how does it work? What areas do you look at?
Yeah, people's participation was the reason why we came out of university also, because we were academic kind of group at that time, some of the research students, but we were also helping the people who were affected because of the sugar. There are two major industry in that area, that sugar cane growing area. So distillery, and the sugar factory. These are the two main industries. So because of the pollution of the industries, the effect which is happening to the farmers in terms of polluting their fields, agriculture field, the fertilizer factory actually, which is producing a lot of emissions, and that is causing the problem for the crops and so on. So all these problems. So we were helping the farmers by providing them data and information, analysis of the effluent, so that they can do the advocacy, they can fight their cases for their compensation, for negotiation with the industry, for taking the issues to the government. So that actually started the participation thing. And because of that, actually, people started coming to our group also. And then university, was not very comfortable that, so we came out of university, and then we started our main work from out of university on different issues of environment. So we worked on sustainable or ecological agriculture, then floods and waterlogging, then climate change related issues, urban climate change resilience, and so on. So that is the timeline, the history of the organization.
Can you throw also some light on some of the important movements that you have, movements that you have led or achievements that you have got through working in these areas and ensuring that some change takes place?
Yeah, one issue is also we have largely small and marginal farmers. That is the primarily that area actually depends for the livelihood on agriculture or agriculture related activities, whether it is livestock or fisheries and so on. So agriculture and allied activities. So and the land holding is very small. It's quite fertile land, and the density of people is very high. Because of that, land fragmentation is quite high, and a very small piece of land which is available to a farmer who has to fully depend for their livelihood, for the livelihood of their families, on that small piece of land. So the small and marginal farmers are in plenty. And gradually, with the advent of Green Revolution and the impact of the Green Revolution, the input cost in agriculture was gradually going up. So what happened gradually is that the net gain which the farmers were getting was kind of narrowing down. So the input cost was increasing, the output cost also increased, but not to that extent, and the input cost kept on growing, but the output cost actually was it became stagnant after some point of time. So the net gain was less and less. So that is how we started doing ecological agriculture. So how low external input ecological agriculture is the answer. And then we started working with the farmers, the small and marginal farmers, and the women farmers. And they came together, and then we also tried to organize them for making their own organizations, understanding the whole issue of low external input agriculture, do the advocacy with the government, do the advocacy with the seed companies and so on, and ensure that their capacities and their priorities are met.
So the way the urban planning is moving, the way the development is taking place, the marginalized section of the society is left out of it. They're not thought about. And also in the process, there are also various public spaces that are taken over by the state, by the private companies, by the government, which is also directly or indirectly related to the livelihood of the people. How do you see that aspect of this entire urban planning that is taking place at such a massive level?
If you talk of the livelihood of poor people, who are not so economically very strong, and there are marginalization because of various reasons, social reasons, gender reasons, and so on. There's so many reasons, caste-based, developmental processes, and so on. So the thing is that the poor people are largely dependent on these commons, common property resources, for their livelihood. The fodder comes from the commons. The food also comes from the commons, water bodies. You get fish, you get singhala, you get talmakhana, and so a number of things actually. You get fuel from the commons. So the commons actually provide free input to the livelihood system of the poor people. But gradually what is happening, both in the rural and the urban area, is that these commons are going. And this is diminishing very fast. And you go to any village, or you go to the urban, especially in the urban, you talk in the urban area also. In the urban areas also, these water bodies or these commons, where the ecosystems and their services, what we call ecosystem services, these ecosystem services are providing free input to the livelihood cycle of the poor people. But with the powerful lobby, they grabbing the land, the builders lobby, the real estate mafias and so on, the social and politically empowered people, actually they try to grab those land and those common things. The common property resources are for everybody, and that is why it is nobody's property. Okay. So nobody object. So it is easier for encroaching on those lands and those water bodies. So gradually it has gone down. And what I was talking is that also that in a city like Gorakhpur, where we had almost 103 water bodies a few decades back, now we have only 18 water bodies which remains. So that is the kind of degeneration of the common property resources which is happening. And because of that, the citizens are in problem. We are in the problem. The government is in the problem.
Not only water bodies, but also public spaces, right? Parks for children to play. And also, there used to be these squares where people used to sit, chat, have tea, talk about politics. So that entire development process is also getting hampered because of this kind of urban development that we are witnessing. Am I right?
Two incidences I will like to mention here is, like, I was in World Urban Forum recently in Kuala Lumpur last week, 10 days back, a week back only. So the children of Kuala Lumpur, they demonstrated in front of the world leaders that they do not have any playing spaces left in Kuala Lumpur. So that is the kind of things actually which are happening in most of the cities. The second is that in the heat action plan, which is developed for Gujarat, I mean Ahmedabad and all those cities, the thing is that the commons have reduced, and because of the heat, actually, the rich people can buy air conditioners, they can buy resilience, but the poor people cannot buy those things. They have to go to some shady places, some parks, some open spaces. So they have to go there for the, so even the climate change impact or the disaster impact, that is also, I mean, the open spaces are also helping them into building their capacities for the resilience. So it is very important that these commons and the open spaces are protected, are part of the urban system and the rural system, because of which we all will get benefited.
So also, this would be my last question. Gorakhpur has been in news since last 1 year for some other reasons as well, Japanese encephalitis. More than 100 children have died, and it continues to happen every year, but nobody seems to be paying attention towards it. How do you see that issue, and is your group also involved in such issues?
Yeah, it is unfortunate that it is happening for such a long time, and every alternate or every year children are dying. I will say that we have to take concrete measures. Everybody actually who is part of this system, whether it is government or it is public or it is medical doctors or women, whosoever, and have to see that government is trying to make the treatment system better and stronger. But we will also have to see how the causes of the problem, actually, they are also addressed. Unless you address the causes, if the waterlogging is increasing, the breeding spaces for the mosquitoes are increasing, the groundwater table is getting contaminated, the water bodies are going. So, I mean, we have to see in a holistic manner so that the common person, actually, who, and the poor people, actually, is again, this disease is happening mostly in the poor people, actually, who are coming from the remote villages. So we have to see that these services and these, like safe drinking water, safe sanitation facilities, proper surveillance mechanism, that exists and that reaches to the poor people also. And also the treatment system is very important, and that has to be strengthened. But at the same time, the causal factors which are responsible for the problem is also important to be addressed with the people's participation.
Thanks a lot, sir, for giving us your time, and all the best for your future endeavors. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Thank you for watching NewsClick. Keep following our website and our Facebook page.